bless you. God bless you. It's beyond. You have space in your program at the stakes for the pastor for us to celebrate the pastor's birthday. It was on the 21st of this month.
Yeah.
The first Father's Day, the last week Women's Day. So we reserved today for you to bring your love tokens and gifts and what have you. There have been a lot of people have already turned in cards and gifts. So at this time, if you have that love token, that card or what have you, would you stand please and bring it forward so we can present it to the pastor? Thank you.
Daniel chapter 3, verse 8. Wherefore at the time certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. Thou, O king, hast made the decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth, that he should be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. I want to continue from my sermon in the 8 o'clock service, Fist in the Face of God. Fist in the Face of God. Be seated in His presence. I want to share with you that this worship experience is a repeat of what happened at 8 o'clock this morning. The power of the Lord is resting and the glory of God is in this house. Let me tell you, I'm not going to be able to finish it, so meet me on Wednesday night at 7 so I can complete this. I'm concerned about the rulings of the United States Supreme Court in the last week. In 1 week, they have struck down the Roe v. Wright Act of 1965. They have set aside the Defense of Marriage Act and ruled it unconstitutional. And they've set aside Proposition 8 in California, which allows the continuation of same-sex marriages. Let me tell you what this message is not about. It is not about fear-mongering. It is not homophobic. It is not gay bashing. Because if we do that, then we're going to go better than the world. But it is about making a clear distinction between the law of man and the law of God. Being very clear that living in this ship and growing in the Spirit requires a demonstration of non-negotiables. Say with me, non-negotiables. There's certain things in life that are just non-negotiable. There's some places in your life where you will bend a little, where you'll give in a little, where you can see some latitude, some elasticity in a negotiation, some room to kind of change or modify. But then there ought to be some things in your life that are just not up for discussion. Your salvation should be one of those things. Your relationship with God should be so that it is not up for negotiation because He has already stated it in His Word. You see, there's a whole lot that we don't have to talk about because God has already spoken on it. And if God has declared it, then we just need to obey it because the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Non-negotiables. We're going to live in this ship, in this new place. And I've been declaring since the beginning of June, heard it in my spirit, that God is shifting, that we're in this ship. I've been preaching about it. And the real thing is that the whole earth is shifting. Too many times we come to church and think that this word is just for us locally. This is a word for the body of Christ. The entire nation is shifting. And they're shifting away from God. They've been on this course for a very long time. But they haven't been on this course by themselves. They had some assistance. They had assistance of an unactive, as Mother Freeman said in her prayer, a sleeping church. A church that falls asleep and will not engage in the transformation of a community in which it seeks for salvation is culpable to whatever happens in Washington. What you will not do at home, you cannot complain that they've done in Congress. just won the battle on the cross, but we still have the battle in the streets. We still got a battle in our home. We still have a battle for education. We still have a battle for health care. We got a battle for equality. The fight is not over, but God has given us power to understand that He has positioned us to be progressive and not to be oppressive. We need to move forward. We need to stop talking about folk and complaining. And the enemy has got the church choose to lie, that's what you won't do. My bishop is here. We're going to hear from him in a few moments. But I'm going to tell you something, that when I was in city government, I walked in saying who I was. I walked in declaring and drawing the line. So that we didn't even have the argument about leveraging and compromising. Because guess what? I read the book. If Joseph could be in government, if Daniel could be in government, if Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego can be in government, come on here. If Nehemiah can be in government, then so can you. What am I saying to the church? You need to get re-engaged in your community. You can't talk about youth crime and you're not volunteering doing nothing. You can't talk about the homeless and you won't help them. If you have the love of God in you and shut up your bowels of compassion, how dwell it? You see your brother in need. You know people are hurting and you would drive past them. You'll talk about them. You'll talk about women that can't come to church and the skirts are too high. Go to the mall. Buy them a dress. Is hate. tempted him three times. He tempted him on a natural level. He said, if you're hungry, turn the stones into bread. Then he tempted him in his pride. He said, you know what this kingdom, all this kingdom's will give you if you bow down and worship. Because the real issue is that's how the enemy is working with us. He's working with your pride. Don't look at me like I'm crazy. The real issue is he's working at your pride. He has pumped you up so big that you believe your own headlines. You believe that you are greater than somebody else. Same temptation, same tricks. These texts portray that there's a distinction between the law of God and the law of man. And I want to say this, that blind obedience to government is never right. It is never right. However difficult or costly it may be, we must all reserve the right to say no to things that we consider oppressive or immoral. In our text today, in Daniel chapter 3, I wasn't dealing with the furnace. I was dealing with the objection. Because the real issue here is the fact that there were people that came to Nebuchadnezzar and said, you know those three Hebrew boys that you put in charge of certain parts of the kingdom? They said, the problem here is that they're not bowing down. You've got a law that they're not complying with. And I want to share with you that when the government makes an unjust law, you have to refer to the law of the kingdom and not the law of the land. Pastor, are you promoting civil disobedience? I'm promoting being a citizen of the kingdom of God. And if this is what the Bible says, and it's against what man says, then I know that we ought to obey God rather than man. So they said, well, who is it? They said, it's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The first thing I want to tell you, that wasn't who that was. Those were their Babylonian names. You see, because their Hebraic names were Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. But the problem was, when Babylon had secured Jerusalem, they changed their names. And they gave them Babylonian names so that they could fit into a Babylonian culture. Ain't nobody talking to me. I'm the only person in this building who ever saw roots in that famous scene where Kunta Kinte is strung up like an animal. And they're beating him, ripping his flesh off, and saying, what's your name? And he said, my name is Kunta Kinte. And they kept beating him until the people knew they would kill him. And then he whispered and said, my name is Tony. When you allow the enemy to identify you, and they will gerrymander voter of election districts
witness necessary. Until we take responsibility for being in the kingdom of God. So here we go, y'all. I'm done. No, I'm not done. I'll finish on Wednesday. The real issue here is that corporations, they've got the owner of Chick-fil-A, took a stand. And watch this. And they came after him. They went after him. Because that was his personal conviction.
That's right.
That was his non-negotiable.
That's right.
He didn't say that people couldn't come and do a star. He just said, this is what I say. Until you need to go home today and talk to your kids and ask them, what are your non-negotiables? What are your core values? How do you see the world? Because you will be surprised that your kids are saying what the news says. This is where they belong. You can't tell them, don't hang out with Johnny them anymore. You've got to make sure that they know how to be uniquely them. That they're comfortable in their saved, sanctified seat. You want to talk about homosexual marriages? Forget that. Talk about building better marriages in the church. Talk about having strengthening marriages in the church. You can't go after homosexuals on marriage, because then they'll say, well, what's the divorce rate in the church?
Devotion to God, and that God exists. If you can take the heat,
installed our church mother. I want to be a blessing to her. Mother Nelson tells me all the time, she says, son, don't do nothing to laugh. She got a video on, I'm a little bougie. But this is the way I grew up. I grew up honoring my elders. I was 5 years old, putting on the mother's boots in the back of the hallway at Pentecostal time. In the winter, I was on my knees. They would all sit in this row along this thing. They were just waiting for what they called me, their chocolate brown baby. And I said, they called me that. Don't know that y'all called me. And I put on their boots. I'd walk into their car. Because I've always loved my elders. Always respected the saints. Can I tell you something? God will bless you for who you honor. And watch this. You'll be cursed for who you dishonor. That's why his word says, honor thy father and thy mother. Who you choose to honor, God will open up and access a way of blessing and elevation. And you never get nothing taken away from you when you choose to honor people. That's why I don't understand the church. If you just be faithful and hang out, God knows where you're at. When you ask if you pass that offering down to the person seated on the end of your row nearest the center aisle and have that person stand for your row. Come on, I need you to give today. The deacon's going to come and receive that offering at this time. And I want to thank you for your generosity. I want to thank you for your benevolence. How many of you heard the word of the Lord today? I want you to come back on Wednesday night because I want to really unpack some things and share some stuff. For the sake of time today, I will never cut off worship as the Lord is blessing his people. I'm so glad for not only the young, give me the whole family reunion with the names. The Young. What'd you say?
Young, Russell.
Young, Russell, and Smith. Family reunion. The blessing of the Lord is upon you all. I want to share very quickly with you all, but I want to share very quickly house rules. When we recess and we bring the bishop out, and this family will follow us in our recession. I want everyone to remain standing until the elders and the choir have recessed. Then we shall dismiss. Please do not cut in front of and be respectful one to another. But Tyra told me about Tyra. Stand up, Tyra. This young woman, and I don't have all the details, but I want to show you what God will do. This young woman was sick unto death in New York City. I'll never forget that Tia, stand up Tia. Tia was that we were at Pentecostal Temple and we were in rehearsal because I sang with the worship team. And we were rehearsing and we had church. And so I asked for prayer requests and she talked about Tyler. And we went into prayer with her family and everybody else. But we went into prayer and I remember asking God about your lungs. I remember praying and saying, Lord, resuscitate her and fill her lungs. I knew that, and it was bad. But when I saw her, I didn't even know who she was. I was speaking to her. Tina said, you remember who we was praying for? Where she at? Right there. That is a miracle. Thank you. then I would continue doing what I was doing. I came to my bishop when this opportunity came, and he said, let's pray about it. And then when he released me to consider it, that's when I knew. I wasn't coming here without any covering. And so when I found out he was here, I'm sorry, but there's still a boy in me that appreciates a father. And it's good when your father can come and see what you're doing. I bless the Lord for his work. Will you receive Bishop Linwood H. Young, Prelate of Jurisdiction Number 2, West Trenton, New York.
Texas or wherever you're from and from all over the nation.
all the world and convince men and women that this is the last days. We've got to tell somebody about Jesus Christ. God bless.
I'm just going to wait for you.
Stand up, Sister Burke, just Sylvester Burke and Sister Burke there. Just let me do this because this is their 40th wedding anniversary.
Thank you very kindly.